Okay, let's pray. Let's pray before service. Father, thank you. Father, you call us before the ages, and you prepared this place, this sanctuary. And now we are here to listen to your word, and to see you, and to love you, Father. Father, please give us proper heart. We want to give you this worship properly. And we want to one step forward to you through this service. This is a time for praise and prayer. Please accept our praise and answer our prayers. We put all the worships and our praises and prayer into your arm. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
I can describe. All my fears fade away. Drawing me closer to your side. And I never will. When I heard you say to me, welcome to the Father's house. We await with open arms, where your sins are washed away and your name gone. Come into the Father's house.
Let's rest here.
As we rest here in your presence, there is a peace I can describe. All my fears fade away. Drawing me closer to your side.
Let's praise Here I Am again.
More than it away, and to you I after my life. Will it ever dare to break us from your wonderful love we have? Till the end I will live my life for you. Who will dare to stop? I will never stop. Every single day, it's the rhyme to be the world. For to your glory will I ever be. Forever I will sing. I sing of your love that set me free. And within you where you gave it away. And Lord, you have rescued my soul. Forever I will sing. I sing of your love that set me free. Everything I have I gave it away. And to you I after my life. Will ever dare to break us from your wonderful love we have. Till the end I will live my life for you. Who will dare to stop? I will never stop. Every single day is a promise to meet your love. Lord, to your glory will I ever be.
Till the end, one more time.
Till the end I will live my life for you. Who will dare to stop? I will never stop. Every single day is a promise to meet your love.
Together that the first thing is for this country and for the whole world, wherever you are from, for your own country, and also please pray for this nation, Korea. Another thing is, as you heard, the second service, March 13th to 16th, there will be a Pakistan seminar, Redemptive Series. They planned and we want 200,000 people. That's a big number. But if we pray and if we fill the jar with our prayer to the top, anything, we believe that anything can happen. Everything can be answered. So let's pray for that. And also let's pray for our families and around us who are in need of our prayer. Please pray for Oh Min Sik. Say his name with your mouth. And this young boy, he's still unconscious. He's still in ICU, as I heard. So Please pray for him. All we can do is just pray for him, and he will do. Let us sing still. Thank you.
Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this blessed Lord's Day service and this brand new year of 2017. Father, we ask that you will soften our hearts so that we can receive the bread of life in which you have prepared for us this day. For we know that it is by your awesome grace and compassion that we are able to be here and receive the redemptive history. And we know that it is by your power and Holy Spirit that we are able to believe in you, Father, and trust in you. Father, even though you have called and chosen us as your covenantal people and nourished us with your word, we have not always walked according to your ways. So we ask for your forgiveness, and we pray that in this year of 2017, we can overcome all of our insufficiencies and be victorious and accomplish all things according to your will and vision for global missions. Father, let us become united as one by your awesome power so that Shiloh International Missions will become the center for proclaiming and broadcasting the word of redemptive history and for the nations of the world to come and settle and receive grace and salvation as you have given to our Pyongyang Chael Church. And Father, may the power of your word be unleashed during the seminar in Pakistan. Father, may your Holy Spirit, Father God, open up the hearts of the people who will come in here. And Father, as we begin this Lord's Day service, we pray for the man of God that you have sent to us, our beloved Pastor James. Bless him, use him mightily as he proclaims the word. And Father, may you be in full control of this Shiloh worship service from start to finish. We ask in the precious and glorious name of our Lord, Savior, and Jesus Christ with thanksgiving. Amen. Scripture reading comes from one place today, Joshua chapter 11, verses 23. In the Old Testament, Joshua chapter 11, verse 23. Read along as I read. Joshua took the whole land according to all that the Lord had spoken to Moses, and Joshua gave it for an inheritance to Israel according to their divisions by their tribes. Thus the land had rest from war. This is the word of God. Amen. We'll hear from our choral anthem.
Oh, my soul, pray. Shiloh Choir for that wonderful praise. Did you have a good lunch? Hallelujah. Amen. Yes. Through today's passage, Joshua 11, verse 23, I want to share the title, The Administration in Redemptive History in the Process of Allotting the Land. Big title. So, the administration of redemptive history in the conquest of Canaan. Is the title for today. The verse is Joshua 11:23. Let's read that verse again. Joshua 11:23. Let's read that all together again. Ready, begin. So Joshua took the whole land according to all that the Lord had spoken to Moses, and Joshua gave it for an inheritance to Israel according to the divisions by their tribes. Thus the land had rest from war. And this is the word of God. Now, this lesson or this lecture is based off of the eighth book of the History of Redemption series. And as you know, the eighth book is actually kind of the sister book, the continuation of the second book. So how many of you read the second book? Yes. Now, the eighth book has not yet been translated into English yet, but from what I hear, it's on its way. But it's like the sister book. It's like the continuation of the second book. The second book is the Covenant of the Torch, right? And if you want to make a difference, or if you want to contrast the two, they're both in relation to the fulfillment of the Covenant of the Torch. But the difference is, I want to tell you the difference, and this will help you read the books better. The difference is, the second book is based on more of the people of faith and how the Covenant of the Torch fulfilled through the people with the living faith. Living faith. And so it's a living God, a living faith. And how the fourth generation was fulfilled through Joseph when his bones were buried in Shechem, right? But the eighth book is more focusing on not the people, but of course the people, you know, are mentioned, but it's focusing on the land, focusing on the land. It's focusing on God's promised land, the inheritance that God has given to them. And so that's what the whole eighth book is talking about. Because through the fall of Adam and mankind, we see that God's people were lost, and also God's land, God's territory, his domain had been lost. And so the covenant is ratified in order to recover God's people and God's land. And that becomes the kingdom of God. That becomes the kingdom of God. And so the covenant of the torch, the covenant of the torch, covenant of the torch is one out of the seven covenants that God had ratified with Abraham. But the covenant of the torch is actually the central covenant of all covenants because it's like the blueprint. It's like the blueprint of the entire process of redemptive history in recovering God's people and in restoring and redeeming God's land and his people. And so the covenant of the torch is the central covenant of all the covenants. Now, just to review what we learned last week, I want to go over the chronological framework. So just to review, and then we'll start to get into the specifics. Now, God made the covenant of the torch with Abraham. He ratified the covenant of the torch. And at that time, Abraham was 84 years old. And it was in the year 2082 BC. Now, at that time, God established the covenant of the torch, and he also gave the specific boundaries of the land. So it was at this point that God specifically told what land it was and the boundaries of the land. And so especially if you look at Genesis chapter 15, verses 18 through 21, God gives the outline of the boundaries to the land of Canaan. And so if you look at that, just to give you a little picture, a little map, and we'll continually use this map. No, right? Okay. Not yet. Okay. You know what I'm... All right. Next time, right? Okay. All right. Now, we want to draw a map here of Canaan. Now, here is the Mediterranean Sea. Here is the Sea of Galilee. Here is the Jordan River. And this is the Jordan River. And this is the Dead Sea. Okay. Now, if you look at Genesis chapter 15, verse 18 through 21, God actually gives the boundaries. And what he says is that that the boundaries of the land of Canaan starts with the great river Egypt. So this is the river Egypt. And then also, he also gives another boundaries, and it's also a river. This is the Euphrates here. Euphrates River. So this becomes the boundaries for the land of Canaan that God specified. Can we turn to that in Genesis chapter 15, verse 18? Let's turn there. We will be looking in our Bibles and checking each verse just to confirm. Now, Genesis chapter 15, verse 18. Okay, so let's read that together. Ready, begin. Abraham saying, to your descendants I've given this land from the river of Egypt as far as the river Euphrates. So here is the river Egypt, and here is the Euphrates River. And so this whole piece of land becomes the land that is promised to Abraham and his descendants. But we have to remember that this covenant is not just relating to the physical descendants of Abraham, but it applies to us today. Psalms chapter 105, verses 5 through 8, shows us that this covenant of the torch is eternal covenant. It is everlasting covenant. And what this shows us is that, if you look at this picture here, that it is a picture of the recovery of the land and the people is a picture of our life of faith today. And so, Egypt is like the picture of the world. They come out of Egypt. Then they have the 40 years of wilderness journey. And they cross the Jordan River here. They cross the Red Sea there. And they go into the Canaan land. They go into Canaan land. This is promised to Abraham's descendants. But if you look at Galatians chapter 3, verse 27, and if you go further to 29, what this shows us is that we are the spiritual children of Abraham. Amen? I believe that as we believe in Jesus Christ, that he becomes our father, right? And we become the descendants, the spiritual descendants of Abraham. We are Abraham's offspring, and God becomes our father, amen? And the land that is given to us is not a physical land, but it's talking about the eternal land, which is the kingdom of God. This is the kingdom of, signifying the kingdom of God. So this journey that the Israelites went through, coming out of the world, if you look at Revelation chapter 11, verse 8 and verse 9, Egypt is symbolic for the world, all right? And they crossed the Jordan, they crossed the Red Sea, and they came into the wilderness. The wilderness is also a picture of our lives of faith in the church. So this is the congregation in the wilderness. And this promised land, it becomes the promise of the kingdom of God. And so this journey becomes our journey. And this shows us what kind of faith that is required from us by God in order to go into the land of Canaan. And especially, you know that 603,448 people of the first generation of the Israelites had all died, including Moses and Aaron and Miriam. But only Joshua and only Caleb, along with the second generation Israelites, went into Canaan land alive. And so their faith is an example to us of what kind of faith and what kind of lives we need to live. And before they crossed the Jordan River, God promised through Moses the 1,000-fold blessing. The 1,000-fold blessing. And may this 1,000-fold blessing be upon Shiloh this year. Amen? Amen. Think about it. So 1,000-fold. Let's say you have a dollar. 1,000-fold times, 1,000 times one. That's $1,000. So already that's significant. Let's say you have like $2 times by 1,000. That's like $2,000. So let's say like $5 times by 1,000. That's five times. You get the idea, right? All right. I'm getting all mixed up in the multiplication. That's too hard for me. Anyways, let's look up Deuteronomy chapter 1, verse 11. This 1,000-fold blessing is actually very important. We need this 1,000-fold blessing, not only in terms of material possessions, but there's a spiritual significance behind that. So Deuteronomy chapter 1, verse 11. Now, let's read that all together. Okay, ready, begin.
May the Lord, the God of your fathers, increase you, and allow the Lord more than you are, bless you, as he promised.
Okay, so Deuteronomy 1:11 shows the 1,000-fold blessing, right? We just read that. Is that correct? Yes. Now, if you turn to Deuteronomy chapter 32, verse 30, let's read that together. Deuteronomy chapter 32, verse 30. So this is more of a spiritual blessing as well, not just a physical blessing. So let's read that together. Ready, begin. How could one chase 1,000 and two put 10,000 to flight? Unless the rock had sold them and the Lord had given them up. Amen. So what is this saying? Is that one person can chase away 1,000 people. But two people can chase away 10,000 people. So we need the 1,000-fold blessing in order to conquest and to go into war and to take up the land of Canaan and drive out all of the Canaanites in the land. But it's not something that we could do by ourselves. By ourselves, we may be able to drive out 1,000. But with two people, that is multiplied, and we can drive out 10,000 with two people. God says where two or three are gathered in his name, God is amongst them. And whatever you pray in his name, God will answer. And so I believe that Shiloh needs to receive the 1,000-fold blessing so that we may come together and pray in agreement so that we may be able to conquest the spiritual Canaan land, so that we may conquest the whole world with the History of Redemption series books. And I pray and bless this upon you in the name of the Lord. Amen. Now, first point I want to cover is crossing the Jordan, real quick. Crossing the Jordan. Now, as you know, they were crossing the Jordan in 1406 BC. Okay? And so, they had finished the 40 years of wilderness journey, and now they're ready to cross the Jordan River, but Moses had died, and the people were, so Moses was not with them anymore. The great leader had gone. He's not with them. And the people were in a very low state. You know, they were just depressed, and they were discouraged, and they just didn't know what to do. But God appears to Joshua and tells him to be strong of heart and be courageous. He told him to have faith and take possession of the land that God had promised them. And so God told Joshua to arise. Arise with the people. Stand up. Don't be down and depressed. But it is time to rise up and to move forward in terms of God's redemptive history. And so I believe that this year is the time where Shiloh is going to move forward in terms of the administration of redemptive history. Amen? Amen. We have to start now thinking big and start thinking about conquesting the world and start to now think about what do we need to do to spread the History of Redemption series word. And that is our task. But the first thing that we need to do is arise. God told Joshua to arise. And physically to arise, spiritually to arise, and to go forward and take the land. Be of strong heart. Be strong of a strong courage. And by faith, take the land that I have given to you. It's already given to us. And we have to go and step on it. And we have to receive that promise. Amen. We have to receive that. Isaiah. Isaiah chapter 60. Verse 1 through 3. Why don't we read that? Isaiah chapter 60, verses 1 through 3. Why don't we read that? All right. Isaiah chapter 60, verses 1 through 3. Now let's read it responsibly. I'll read first. Arise, shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord has risen upon you. And let's read verse 3 all together. Ready? Begin. And nations will come to your light, and kings to the brightness of your rising. Right. So if you also look at 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 13, 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 13, starting from verse 10 to 13, what it says is that God is called us as his holy nation, the royal priesthood, right? And he has called us from darkness into his marvelous light. Amen? He has called us from darkness, from a place of deep darkness, into his marvelous light of his word to proclaim the excellencies of him who has called us. So what is the purpose of us being called by God? It is to proclaim. It is to proclaim the gospel. And so our task as Shiloh is to proclaim the excellencies of him who has called us from darkness and into his marvelous light. And we need to grab that vision. Proverbs, Proverbs, I'm getting mixed up here. Proverbs chapter 20, verse 27 says that the spirit of the man is the lamp of the Lord. So we are spiritual lamps for God, and we have to shine brightly. We have to shine brightly so that the nations will come to our light. And so, you know, how can you evangelize if we're always going to be down and depressed and sick and you know, always in need? But now we need to arise and shine our light. And what did Jesus say? We have to be the salt and light of this world. So we literally have to shine in this world in all the areas of our lives so that the Gentiles, those who are non-believers, will come to our light and they can be evangelized. You know, at work or at school, people will see your light and they'll see that you're different. Hey, I can see that you're always at peace, that you always have a smile on your face, that I can see that you're always calm and there's something different about you. And, you know, I can see that you're successful. Why is that? And people will wonder what is different about you. But if you don't even have that difference, if you don't have the light of God, we cannot, you know, be an effective witness for God. And so in this year, we have to arise and shine. We have to be able to be like the stars and the moon and that shine the light of God. And may you be able to grab this task and be able to be the salt and light of this world. And I pray and bless this upon you in the name of the Lord. Amen. We have to shine our lights. We cannot be depressed or down or discouraged or despaired. But we have to now arise. We have to take courage. What is bringing us down in our lives of faith? What is discouraging for us? What is making us sad? What is causing us pain in our lives? What is that hurt in our lives that is causing us grief? And so those things we need to settle and put away. And now we have to become a new person in Christ and go forward in our lives of faith. What happened was that they crossed the Jordan River. And where did they settle? They settled in 1406. In Gilgal, right? And so in Gilgal, they set up the tabernacle, and it became the headquarters. Now, if you look at the map, here is the last place that they camped outside of Canaan, and they came in, and they camped at Gilgal here. Gilgal. So this becomes Gilgal right here. And that became the headquarters for the first 6 years from 1406 BC until 1400 BC. Let's just go up to here. For 6 years, the home base was camped at Gilgal along with the tabernacle, and that became their headquarters. And this became the base where they drew up their strategies and formed their plans and started to conquest the land of Canaan. But also in the land, when they went into the land of Canaan, when they camped at Gilgal, God told Joshua to circumcise the Israelites. Circumcise. And so if you look at Joshua chapter 3, if you look at Joshua chapter 3, verses 1 and the following, God gives a command to circumcise the children, the second generation children. And so what is this talking about? This is talking about putting away the old self, right? And putting on the new man. And it's becoming the true children of God. Why? Because only the true children of God, the true sons of God, have the right to possess the land, right? It is our inheritance as the children of God. But we cannot become children of God unless we are spiritually circumcised, unless we are truly God's children. And so God told the people to become circumcised so that they can become the true sons of God. And if you look at Romans chapter 8, verse 15, this shows us that the creation is groaning for the true sons of God to appear. The creation is saying, the ground is saying, when are the true sons going to appear and I can become their land? So they're like, come and take over me. The land is groaning, right? They're waiting for the true sons. They're tired of the unbelievers, you know, wasting away their land. And so creation is groaning eagerly for the true sons of God to appear. And that is, I believe, is us, the people of Shiloh, with the word of God. Amen? Amen? Amen. And so crossing the Jordan River, if you look at 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 1 through 3, crossing the Red Sea was like a baptism for the people, right? Crossing the sea, Red Sea was a baptism, right? But when they crossed the River Jordan, and what that was is it's a symbolism of going into the kingdom of God, and it is throwing away all of the earthly things and becoming a spiritual person. And so what does Gilgal mean? It means to roll away the reproach, right? And so through becoming circumcised and through this process, God rolled away the reproach, the guilt, and all of the past sins of the people. And he said, I'm going to start new, and you're going to take this land. And so God says, forget the past. I'm doing a new work. This is a new start. And so I believe that 2017 has to be a new work, a new start for Shiloh. Amen? All of the past has to be washed away and going down the River Jordan. All of the reproach and shame. We have reproach and shame in our lives, but all of that is going to be rolled away. Amen? But the greatest reproach, the greatest shame is what? Is death. So let's turn to Isaiah chapter 25, verse 8. God is going to roll away the greatest reproach, which is death. So Isaiah chapter 25, verse 8. Can we read that? Ready? Begin. Have we found it? All right. Let's say it all together. Ready, begin. For the Lord has spoken. So what does it say? He will remove the reproach. So what does this reproach is talking about? The greatest reproach and shame is talking about death. Death. And so God is going to roll away death once and for all. He's going to swallow it up. And so that word swallow is also used by Apostle Paul in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 50 to 53. And he says, at the last trumpet, those who are dead in Christ will rise again in the resurrection, right? And those who are alive at the last trumpet will be transfigured. They'll be changed. And they will go into heaven without seeing death, like Enoch and Elijah. This is called the transfiguration. And death, the last enemy, death, will be swallowed up for all time. And this is the great hope that we have in our lives of faith. Amen? Amen. This is what the senior pastor, Dr. Reverend Abraham Park, has always proclaimed from the beginning, the word of transfiguration. It is not to see death, but to go into heaven alive without seeing death. So may 2017 be a year where all of the reproach in our lives be removed and that we may have a new start and a new work in our lives. And I pray and bless this upon you in the name of the Lord. Amen. Now, secondly, we're going to look at the 6 years of war, and then we'll end for today. Next week, we'll talk about the allotment of the land. But today, we'll just talk about the 6 years of war. The 6 years of war. Now, The 6 years of war took place from when? 1406 to 1400, right? So this is the six-year period right here. Six-year period. 6 years. The reason why we know that is because if you look at Joshua chapter 14, verse 7 and through 10, we see that Caleb is confessing his age, right? So he says that he's 85 years old, but when he was sent out as a spy, he was 40 years old. Remember from last week, right? We remember that, right? So I don't have to go into it too in too detail. So in 1405 BC, Caleb is at the age of 40 years old. And so from 1405 to 1400 is 45 years. And so we see that Caleb confesses that he's 85 years old, but he's still as strong as he was when he was sent out as a spy. And so through that, we know that Caleb was 85 years old, and at the time when the years years of war had ended, and so that would make that year 1400 BC, and so that's 6 years of war that the people went through. 6 years of war. So first, what happened was that they entered into Gilgal and they covered this central region here. Central region. The reason why they attacked the central region was to cut off, split off the north and the south from joining together and into coming together and to fight them off. And so there was a split. They made they cut the nation into half, so to say, strategically, and they knifed through, right? And so here they covered Jericho. And then they covered the land of Ai. And here's the land of Gibeon. Gibeon. Like this. All right? And so they covered this central region. And so first, they conquested Jericho and the land of and the city of Ai. And as you know, when they came upon the city of Jericho, there was a great wall, right? The Jericho wall. And it was so fortified that even like tanks could, you know, go over it. But God gave specific instructions to Joshua. And he says, for the first 6 days, just walk around the city one time. Don't say anything. Don't say anything. Just walk around. And the Levites, they took the ark, right? The high priest took the ark, and they led the people. And then on the seventh day, God told them to walk around the city seven times. But when they finished the seven times going around the city, God told them to shout all at once. And when they blew the horns and they shouted, what happened? The walls of Jericho had crumbled down, and they burnt the whole city on fire, and they conquested Jericho like that. And so what is this telling us? This is telling us that we need to obey God's word, and it's telling us to be quiet. Don't say anything, but just pray. So what is this saying? We may have complaints and we may have grumblings in our hearts, but instead of complaining and grumbling, we need to just pray and obey God's word. And I believe that the big walls of Jericho will come crumbling down as we praise God and as we give shouts to God. Amen. So let Shiloh become a time where we shout to the Lord, right? There's that song, Shout to the Lord, right? So the people shouted to the Lord, and the walls came crumbling down. Psalms 119, verse 164 says that I praise God seven times a day, right? Seven is the number of perfection or fullness. And so Psalms 119 says, 119 verses 164 says that I praise the Lord seven times a day. And so we have to be praising the Lord. Psalms 22, verse 3 says, the Lord inhabits the praise of his people. When we praise, God is with us. Amen? Amen. When we praise, God works for us. And he starts to send his terror amongst us. And that terror starts to do the work for us. Amen. And so may we be able to pray and praise and give thanks to God. And I pray and bless this upon you in the name of the Lord. Amen. Also, they went into the land of the city of Ai. But the problem is that God told them not to take things, right? These were the things under the ban. God says, this is the Lord's. Because they needed to offer up the first spoils to God. He says, the first spoils is mine. And you're not supposed to take any of it. But someone took it. Someone took things that was the Lord's. And what was his name? Yeah, Achan. Achan was his name. He took what was the Lord's. And even though they attacked Ai, they failed, right? And so Joshua prayed, and God showed them actually who took the Lord's, the things that were under the ban. Who took the Lord's belongings? And so what is this showing us? We cannot take what is the Lord's, or we cannot have the victory. What is the Lord's? The tithing. What is the Lord's? The Lord's Day. What thanks offerings. Keeping worship. Next week we have the morning prayers from Monday, you know, January 9th to January 13th. We have the morning prayers. The church is gathering together and praying in the morning. The first thing, that's a tithe as well. The first time in the morning is dedicated to God. That's all the Lord's. Your time, your belongings, your possessions, all of your first things, your firstlings, your first crop, that belongs to God. The first day of the week, Sunday, that becomes God's. But if we steal that away from God, we cannot have victory in our lives. And so we have to be really rigid, and we have to really be tight and not taking what is under the ban. That's the Lord's. And so may we be able to reflect in our lives, oh, I didn't pay my full tithes, you know, maybe I didn't, keep the Lord's Day. We have to think about that. We have to give back to God what is his. Amen? Amen. Malachi 3:10 says, when you give the whole tithe to God, God is going to open the storehouse of heaven and pour down a blessing upon you. So much that you cannot even, hold it in. And so may we not take what is the Lord's. And let's offer up our first things to God. And I pray and bless this upon you in the name of the Lord. Amen. They conquered Ai. And now, and secondly, they conquered the southern kings. The southern five kings. So Adonai Sedek heard about what Joshua was doing. And he made an alliance with five kings, right? And they attacked the people of Gibeon. But Gibeon had already made a peace alliance with Joshua. They were really smart people because they say, oh, wow. They say that they knew that they had the spiritual discernment. They said, these people are really the people of God. And so we need to be friends with them. Let's not, make enemies with them. So we have to have that spiritual discernment. We have to make the peace treaties, right? We have to get along with people. And be nice and work with them. We have to have that spiritual discernment like the Gibeonites and make a peace treaty. And so when the kings attacked Gibeon, Joshua was obliged by the covenant to help the people of Gibeon, right? And so God, and as they were fighting in the war, Joshua made the great prayer, sun, stand, right, at Gibeon, right? And so the sun, stood still and they were able to have victory in the war. Where is that found? Let's turn to Joshua chapter 10, verse 12. Let's read Joshua chapter 10, verse 12. Joshua chapter 10, verse 12. This is Joshua's great prayer of faith. Joshua chapter 10, verse 12. Ready? Have we found it? Ready, begin. Then Joshua spoke before the sons of Israel, and he said, in the sight of Israel, O sun, stand still at Gibeon, and O moon in the valley of Ajalon. So Joshua 10:12 shows us that Joshua's faith was hotter than the sun. And he prayed to God. Our faith has to be hotter than the sun. We need to have a passionate faith. Amen. Our faith is what pleases God. But people of Shiloh, we cannot have faith unless we hear the word of God. Romans 10:17 says that faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. But if we don't come to worship services and we skip out, how can we hear the word of God? And so we need to hear the word of God and have a burning faith. And I pray and bless this upon you in the name of the Lord. Amen. Now, third, not only did Joshua conquer the southern section, but he also came up to Hazor, and the united army of the north came down and attacked, and Joshua came and fought with the people of the northern kings, but he had victory in Hazor, and he burnt down the city. And so in this way, Joshua had been able to conquest the whole land, but it did not take 1 or 2 days, but it took a long time, 6 years. And so let's look up a couple more verses, and we'll make a conclusion. Everyone turn to Joshua 11:18. Joshua 11:18. Now, Joshua 11:18. Let's read that all together. Ready, begin. Joshua waged war a long time with all these kings. So that long time is like 6 years of war, continually war, day in and day out. He was fighting and leading the people. Next, this is our main passage today, Joshua 11:23. Let's read the last verse. Ready, begin. So Joshua took the whole land according to all that the Lord had spoken to Moses, and Joshua gave it for inheritance to Israel according to their divisions by their tribes. Thus the land had rest from war. Amen. So in conclusion, next week, I'm going to talk about how it took 10 years to allot the land. And in 1400 BC, they moved from Gilgal to Shiloh, right? And Shiloh became the headquarters. And that's what I'm going to talk about next week, and how they allotted the land. So where do the 12 tribes fit onto this land? So I'm going to talk about the allotment, how they allotted the land, and the inheritance that the people had, and how the tabernacle was moved into Shiloh, and how Shiloh was the home base and the headquarters for the people for 298 years. But for today, as I make a conclusion, I want to ask you the question, what are the wars, the battles that we have in our lives? May it be external wars with our boss, our coworkers? Is it with internal battles with, you know, staff? Is it internal battles like Shiloh people against Shiloh people? Or is it external battles outside? Or is it war within ourselves, right? Apostle Paul even confessed that I have this war inside of me. I desire to do good, but the evil is always there within me. And so it's a battle between good and evil in our hearts. This is a war as well. This is a war. And so we need to have victory first in ourselves, because that is the greatest enemy, one of the greatest enemies, because we want to give up so quickly. We want to just be discouraged and depressed, and we don't want to just do anything. Say, we get hurt and we fall into offense. Right? Say, I don't want to come out in. You guys just do it by yourself. I don't want to do it anymore. You guys, see if you guys can do that without me. And there's that kind of offense. Those are wars within ourselves. We have to overcome that. Mark chapter 7, verses 20 and 21. Mark chapter 7, verses 20 and 21 talks about the seven kinds of sins in our hearts. Let me read that. Mark chapter 7, verse 22. I'll read that for you. From within, out of the heart of men, proceed the evil thoughts, fornications, thefts, murders, adulteries, deeds of coveting and wickedness, as well as deceit, sensuality, envy, slander, pride, and foolishness. See, those are the sins, the different kinds of sins in our lives that come from our hearts. So it's a war within ourselves, the sins of coveting and lust and hatred and all of those things. We have to win that war. Amen? Shiloh, we need to win that war within ourselves. But we also have to win that war with outside as well. You know, there's a competition in the job field. There's competition to get promoted. That's a war. But what is the word that God has for us today? There was rest from that war. And so when there's rest from war, there is peace. And there is promotion. Amen? There is new jobs, right? There's the competition has just been wiped out. And you can go into that new job. You can find that new promotion. You can find the new school. All of those things become our possession. But we have to step and go out and possess that land. Amen? Amen. So, and the Bible. We have to step into the Bible. We need to step and read the Bible and the History of Redemption series books. And that becomes ours. That becomes ours. Amen? We have to read the books. We have to step on the books. And that becomes ours. That becomes our true witness. Remember in Acts, and finally, Acts chapter 1, verse 8, it says, when the Spirit falls upon you, the power of the Spirit falls upon you, you will be my witnesses in Judea, Samaria, Judea, and to the ends of the earth, right? Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, to the ends of the earth, right? So God is saying that when you receive the Holy Spirit, you will be my witnesses. We need to receive the fullness of the Holy Spirit. What is the land talking about? In Matthew chapter 13, the earth or the land is referring to our hearts. So first of all, the Holy Spirit needs to be full in our lives. And we need to be evangelized first. And once we are filled with the Holy Spirit, we can become true witnesses for God's people and for His word. Amen? And so as I wrap up today's word, may we be able to arise, and take courage. We have to have a new vision, a new dream, and go forward in conquesting Canaan. So Shiloh has to plan, you know, evangelistic events. Let's evangelize, amen? We got to drive out and spiritually drive out the Canaanites. That means to evangelize. They need to become our people, right? And so let's make, you know, evangelistic events. Let's invite like 1,000 people and have like an English worship, amen? Do you think we can do that? Amen? And some people might say, oh, I don't know. Be strong and be of good courage. We can do it, amen? We need to have the faith. We can't say, oh, we never did that before. I don't know. We got to get rid of the doubt and we got to think positively based on God's word. Amen? So, or let's have different kinds of events. And I believe that Shiloh can be revived. And so let us go forward, cross the Jordan River, and let us conquest the land of Canaan and have victory in our wars. And I pray and bless this upon you in the name of the Lord. Amen? Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for this precious time in the Lord's Day where we can study the History of Redemption series word. Father, as we learn today, we need to become like the spiritual Joshuas and conquest Canaan with our faith that is hotter than the sun. And may we be able to be equipped spiritually and physically so that Shiloh can become truly a network and the hub for all of the world to come to know this word. Father, may all of the guilt and reproach of Egypt and our past lives be removed and rolled away, and may we become new people in Christ, and may we be renewed daily with the word of God, transforming us daily. And may we be able to move forward and conquest the world. Father, there are many problems in our personal lives, in our families, and in our workplaces, and different areas of our lives. We ask that this year, that you may be able to answer all of our prayers, and may all of our desires and all of our pledges become fulfilled. And may we give glory and thanks to you this year. And we pray all these things in Jesus' precious name with thanksgiving. Amen. Let's give glory to God with our applause.
We've been greatly blessed by the word, the message. Let us turn to hymn number 399. And let's all sing. Can we all sing today and help us out, help everyone out? Go ahead. Standing on the promises, standing on the promises of Christ my King. Through eternal ages let his praises ring. Glory in the highest I will shout and sing. Standing on the promises of God. Standing, standing, standing on the promises of God my Savior. Standing, standing. I'm standing on the promises of God. Standing on the promises that cannot fail. When the howling storms of doubt or fear assail, by the living word of God I shall prevail. Standing on the promises of God. Standing, standing, standing on the promises of God, my Savior. Standing, standing. I'm standing on the promises of God. Let me hear you, Shiloh. Standing on the promises of Christ the Lord. Bound to him eternally by love's strong cord. Overcoming daily with the Spirit's sword. Standing on the promises of God. Standing, standing, standing on the promises of God, my Savior. Standing, standing, I'm standing on the promises of God. Last verse. Standing on the promises, I cannot fall. Listen every moment to the Spirit's call. Resting in my Savior as my all in all. Standing on the promises of God. Standing, standing, standing on the promises of God, my Savior. Standing, standing, I'm standing on the promises of God. Amen. Let us pray for the offering. Father God, we thank you so much for giving us such a precious word by our pastor, James. Father, we pray that we can have the faith to conquer Canaan land. We pray, Father God, that you will continue to work in our lives. Give us strength, Father God, that we may be able to overcome, Father God, all the things that keep us from truly worshiping you in this year 2017. Father, we pray that we can give back, Father, of our talents, of our time, that we may be able to attend all the worship services, Father God, and that we may truly, Father God, call upon you, Father God, and that we may be graced by your word, the history of redemption. And Father, we pray now for the offering that is about to take place, Father. We pray that you would bless those, Father God, give according to their faith. We pray that you would take this blessing, these offerings and tithes, Father God, and use them for the upbuilding of thy kingdom and for proclaiming the gospel throughout the world, that many nations will come singing and dancing to this place to receive salvation. We thank you so much. In Jesus Christ's name, with thanksgiving, we pray. Amen. 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 We have received our tithes and offerings. I'm sure God is pleased. We have one visitor. When I call your name, please stand. Lee G. Sin? Son? Lee G. Sun, please stand.
Love you in the love of the Lord. Yes, I love you with the love of the Lord. I can see it in the glory of the glory of my King.
Amen. Thank you for coming and worshiping with us today. We pray that God will bless you throughout your life, and may he arise in you, and may he arise in Shiloh, that we may conquer the land of Canaan. Amen. Amen. Again, let us pray for our tithe and offerings and our newcomer, our visitor. Father, we thank you so much for this time of praise and worship and fellowship. And we thank you so much for our visitor today. May you work in her life, Father God, and may she bring all of her talents. May you bless her and her family. And Father God, may you give Shiloh, Father God, the strength to arise in 2017, that we may proclaim the gospel throughout the world. We thank you for the tithe and the offerings that we receive, and we pray, Father God, that these offerings be used for thy kingdom. We ask it in Jesus Christ's name with thanksgiving. Amen. Let us turn now into our bulletins, and let's look at our announcements. Please pray for the upcoming Pakistan seminar at Lahore. This is going to take place in March of this year. And the dates are 13 to 16. That's Monday through Thursday. Pakistan is unique among the Muslim countries. And as it has been created in the name of Islam. So Pakistan is an Islamic nation. But here we're going there to take the history of redemption. And I believe the number was we're praying for 200,000 people. So that's a lot of people, right? So let's be fervent in prayer that this seminar, that God's power, God's word would be unleashed in this nation, that those people that come to receive or hear the history of redemption, that their hearts would be truly open up, that they may be able to receive this precious word that's going to be proclaimed there. Amen. Also, we have our dawn services beginning tomorrow. And for the New Year's service, our praise is going to start at 4:40 a.m. And it's going to last from Monday through Friday. So please come out for that. It's going to start tomorrow, 9 January. And it's going to last up until Friday. And praise starts at 4:45 at Moriah Sanctuary. Also, please continue to pray for our brother Benjamin O. We all know that he was in a car accident. He is still in intensive care. But we're hopeful and prayerful that he would be able to arise and that he would be able to be restored fully. So continue to pray for our brother Benjamin. Also, please join us on Wednesday night for intercession prayer here at Shiloh after service. And also, Shiloh members to pray each and every day at 10 p.m. from home or at work for the church and each other for the movement of the history of redemption around the world. And also our Shiloh Bible reading plan for this week is from Genesis chapter 25 through Genesis chapter 42. And I believe that's all the announcements that we have today. Is there anything I forgot? Anything I need to re-say? Okay, I believe that's it. At this time, we have our pastor come up and give us the benediction.
Add a couple of more things there. Yes, March 13th to the 16th is the seminar in Pakistan. And not only is there the crusade for 200,000 in front of 200,000 people, but the senior pastor, Dr. Philip Lee, is going to take 1,000 of the leaders over there. But that's just the leaders, and including all the people, it'll be around 5,000 people. And he's going to teach them the History of Redemption series word with booklets that are being translated into the Pakistani language. And so our deacon, Asher, is really doing a big work in that area, and he's going to be helping with the translation, and we need to pray for him. And truly, this is a great opportunity for the History of Redemption series and the contents to be preached to the rest of the world. So please pray for that. That's going to be a really big event. And if there are people who are interested in from Shiloh who want to go and help out and become a part of that team, you're able to actually sign up. They're going to be accepting 200 people, registrants, and you can get more information through the presidential staff. But we need to really pray for that so that it can become a success. At that time, I will be going away at that time as well, on the same trip, and I'll be part of the team as well as we go over there. And so please pray for us as we take this word to the ends of the world. I really believe that there's a new start that Shiloh has, amen? And so aside from the sermon and the lecture, I want to just heart to heart, just for a few minutes, just to share my heart and to share my thoughts. I'm really happy to be here, and I'm honored and humbled because Shiloh is a great ministry. It has so much potential, and it has a lot of resources here. We just need to be able to use them and to plan it out for God's glory. I'm also over the college group Hepshiba, and so just be aware of that. And so please pray for me. But I believe that, as the word that I got from God, I believe as I was praying, that one can chase away 1,000, but two can chase away 10,000. So why not, do an event with the Hepshiba College Group and combine the two groups, Shiloh and Hepshiba, and work together? And when we do that, I believe that we can truly make a big work for evangelism. Amen? I mean, the college group is like 200 and 300 people, right? So every Saturday we have like almost 200 people coming out. And all of those people can help with Shiloh to create a big event or some, big missions trip. And we can work together. And so that is my heart. And I hope that we can plan something out in the future where we can have a great evangelistic event. Maybe, 1,000 people. I don't know, that number is just in my head. 1,000, I don't know why. 1,000. Why don't we invite 1,000 people, amen? And invite all of our staff workers, our college friends, the people who are from around the world, they study, they're coming here in Korea to study English. And let's invite those foreigners, and let's bring the college kids together, and let's bring Shiloh together, and let's have a big event, maybe even in Moriah, to fill 1,000 people. It's going to be so big, and all of the people will come, and it's going to be a great event. Can you see that? Amen. Can we draw that in our hearts? Amen. So let's pray for those things. That's just the beginning, and there's many work that we need to do. Let's have the benediction, and we'll have the end of the service. Let's all rise up and hymn sing number 6, and we'll have benediction.
To Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, the God whom we adore, be glory as is, was, is now, and shall be evermore, and shall be
And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the everlasting and great love of our Father, the inspiration, the working, and the fullness, and the power of the Holy Spirit may rest upon all of the Shiloh family members, the people that we've left at home on this church and on Korea and the nations that we have left from now and forever and evermore. Amen. Let's give God the glory with our applause.